Okay, all together. Ready? Here we go. God loves you and has a... God loves you and has a difficult plan for your life. Now, this isn't mentioned in witnessing tracts or best-selling Christian books. It's not proclaimed in praise choruses or put on PowerPoint sermon outlines. This isn't the first thing we tell someone who's just prayed the prayer of salvation. God loves you and has a difficult plan for your life. But those of us who've walked with the Lord for a while know that that's true, right? We hear about the God of the wonderful plan. We hear about the God of possibility thinking. We hear about the God who will do well by me if I do well by him. But the God who loves us and plans to make our life difficult? Turn with me to Mark chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. Jesus was just baptized by John the Baptist. Let's begin with verse 10, in fact. It says, as Jesus was coming up out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, you are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased. At once the Spirit sent him out into the desert, and he was in the desert 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels attended him. Are you picturing any of this in your mind as we read it? Here's Jesus. As we mentioned last week, Jesus could have just stepped onto the scene, pushed John aside, said, thanks a lot, but your job is over. I'll take over. He didn't do that. He went in, he got baptized, he identified with the nation of Israel, because that's what Jews did. They identified with one another as part of a nation. A beautiful dove descended upon Jesus. God's voice spoke to Jesus. You are my Son, my beloved. I'm well pleased with you. Similar to Genesis 1:30, where God says, after looking at all of creation, it is very good. Mark is saying that Jesus is the beloved upon whom heaven is showering blessing after blessing, before whom the future spreads out in unimaginable possibility. Isn't that kind of how our spiritual life begins too? We discover God for the first time. We ask him to forgive our sins. We receive Christ into our lives. And then for weeks and months, maybe years, it's as if the heavens open up and the Spirit descends on us. We relish reading the Word. Prayer is a joy. We gain deep insights. We enjoy going to church. We can't wait to share with someone else what we've learned and experienced. We hear God saying to us that we are loved, we're treasured, we're God's own, we're his beloved. A lot of versions put a break between verses 11 and 12 of Mark chapter 1, but in the original manuscripts, there was no break. Jesus went immediately from his water baptism experience to being driven out into the wilderness. The very same Spirit who had descended upon Jesus in the form of a dove in that pristine moment at the river is now driving him into the desert to be tempted, no less. Someone wrote, literally in the Greek in which it was written, Jesus is cast out from the warmth of home and friends, from the comforts of town and village. He's denied even moral and spiritual support. The Torah, the synagogue, the wisdom of the town elders, even, it seems, the comfort of the Heavenly Father's presence. Jesus is driven into the wilderness, deserted by love, to face a hostile adversary all alone. And not just any adversary, but the most powerful and sinister of enemies. This temptation was severe. 40 days and 40 nights of fasting, a thorough and complete period of rigorous self-denial. And on top of that, there were those beasts. Mark seems to be saying something startling in his stark account. God so loved Jesus, his son, that he sent him into a kind of hell. God did this to Jesus, his beloved. The mind reels. A love that casts out, a love that withdraws all loving presence, a love that drives us to the limit of sanity. During World War II, a Russian brigadier commander called a captain to his headquarters and asked for his pistol. Two counterintelligence officers grabbed him from behind and began stripping him of his decorations. "You are under arrest." For what? He was a son of a patriot from World War I. He himself had served with distinction for 4 years. Now that the war was almost over, he wanted to return home to his math teaching, his writing, and his wife. As he was being led away, the commander asked him, "You have a friend in the first Ukrainian front?" He had written a letter to a friend of his criticizing Joseph Stalin. He faced 8 years in prison and decades of exile from his homeland. Alexander Solzhenitsyn went on to become one of the most influential writers of the 20th century from prison, educating the world about the ravages of Soviet communism. He believed that the most significant consequence of his suffering was a renewed relationship with God. Your soul, which formerly was dry, now ripens from suffering. Mark writes that after the angels ministered to Jesus, he went into Galilee preaching, teaching, and healing. So we went from baptism to trial by fire, temptation, immediately into ministry. Jesus' misery prepared him for his ministry. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18 says, "Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested." 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. It's the verses that our declaration was taken from this morning. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others." Suffering is our preparation for ministry in a world of suffering. From trivial irritations of daily life to paralyzing accidents, from family squabbles to church splits, from the ravages of sexual slavery to countless deaths of innocent people at the hands of dictators. This is not a world for shallow people with soft character. It needs tested, toughened disciples who are prepared, like their Lord, to descend into hell to redeem the lost. Some pain is still unexplainable in our finite thinking, but this helps make sense of many of the difficulties that God sometimes directs and sometimes permits in our lives. When we face difficulties, trials, temptations, do we run from it or try to numb ourselves? Or do we think and pray about it, seeking to understand ourselves better and grow to know God better through it? What have we been doing in our minds and our spirits during this pandemic? Have we been feeling sorry for ourselves? Have we hunkered in upon ourselves? Or have we prayed and asked God, "God, what are you doing What's our theme this year? Seeking God's vision in 2020. What is God up to? Have you thought about that? Have you prayed about that? Have you asked the Lord, God, what do you want me to learn through this? How do you want me to change? How do you want me to grow? How do you want me to help someone else? God, as you comfort me, help me to comfort others who may be going through the same or worse than I. The title of my message, God loves us and has a difficult plan for our lives. God's plan for us is a difficult one. But redemption, whether it's personal or social or spiritual, doesn't happen without suffering. Philippians chapter 3, verse 10, Paul wrote, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. Is there a period there? The NIV doesn't have any punctuation at all. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death. What did Paul write in Galatians 2:20? I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But the life that I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. The price that Christ paid was always foremost in Paul's mind. It should also be foremost in our minds. We all want to know the power of Christ's resurrection. But we can never know Christ's life or power unless we come to know his sufferings and death. There has to be a Good Friday before there can be a Resurrection Sunday. God's untamable love surprises us in this. Difficulties and sufferings, it seems, are God's form of hazing. Seems cruel to us, but it's his way of fashioning men and women who will keep their cool when things go horribly wrong and who will stay close to him no matter what. Did you know that in the life of a shepherd, that if a lamb is continually unruly and always wanting to run off, that the shepherd will actually break one of its legs. And then he'll pick it up and carry it around his neck until the leg heals. Because then the lamb will learn to love him and want to be with him. It sounds cruel, but it's really the most loving thing that this person who knows that lamb best and loves it the most is willing to actually break its leg so it'll stay close to him. A news reporter discovered that firefighters can be very cruel to new recruits, making them do all the dirty work, calling them names, and otherwise verbally abusing them. Why? Because the veterans know the psychological toll that is taken by seeing burnt bodies, by seeing people's anguish in losing their cherished possessions to fire, and by seeing their comrades and friends die at an early age. All this compounded by smoke headaches, sore joints, injuries, sore lungs, and nausea. One firefighter told the reporter about another firefighter who had saved a baby by dragging a crib out of a bedroom so hot that the crib melted in his hands. Firefighters are seeking the answer to one question. is this the guy I want coming down the hallway for me if I get trapped in a burning building? Can I trust him, or will he turn around halfway down the hallway and go back? A firefighter who can keep his cool in the kitchen is more likely to remain level-headed when things go horribly wrong in a fire. Similarly, God is testing us, looking for people who will stay close to him no matter what, who will remain cool when life turns up the heat, and will turn around and comfort another person who's going through the same thing. That's what God is looking for in us. He wants us to know what we're made of. Because if we know that, we won't quit when the going gets tough or when the heat gets turned up too high. Our declaration, say it after me. God works through me to strengthen, encourage, and comfort others. Lord, help us to be those individuals that you are looking for, those who will stay close to you no matter what, those who will be faithful through the fire, and those who will turn around and help someone else who needs comforting. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your comforting, for your reassurance when we're going through trials, temptations, pandemics. Thank you that you are always there, that you are always speaking to us, that you will always comfort us, that you will always encourage us. Give us courage to face what we must. That the life that we now live, we live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. God, may we be the people you are looking for, the people you can trust. No matter what the circumstances are around us, no matter what the storm is stirring up, you are our cornerstone. You are the one we stand upon. And we can always trust that our life is in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen.